So if someone asks you what your name is, that information comes to mind quite easily, right? That's something you've stored in long-term memory. Now, what about when someone asks you, what's the capital of Australia or the capital of California? That's some plain old factual information that you can pull from long-term memory, assuming you know those facts, right? But when someone asks where you were last Tuesday morning, that's a really different kind of query to your long-term memory, right? It's about a specific event in time. Likewise, if someone asks how many rooms there are in your present home or apartment, the process of retrieving that information out of long-term memory might be a bit different than for those other questions. Like maybe you mentally visualize yourself going from room to room to answer that question, to retrieve that information. And if someone shows you some letters and asks, is this a valid English word? That's something you can answer based on your brain's stored knowledge of language. But feeling like something is a word or not, that's a different way of utilizing long-term memory. It's more implicit and behind the scenes, right? Likewise, simply for understanding every word that we hear or read, we're retrieving that meaning of each word as we go. As we understand a sentence, we're retrieving all of that from long-term memory, but kind of automatically and behind the scenes. And when someone asks something like, what was Beethoven's telephone number? This also involves long-term memory, but in a kind of unusual way. We have to remember who Beethoven was, roughly when we think he lived, and also access our vague knowledge of when phones first existed, just to parse whether it even makes sense that you would have a phone number or not. So all these questions here are hinting at some kind of distinct types and processes of long-term memory. Now let's just consider why long-term memory is so dang essential. Think about how limited our working memory is. It can only hold a few things for 15 to 30 seconds. So if we didn't have long-term memory, we would be forever stuck in the present. And being constantly in the present may sound nice from like a Buddhist mindfulness perspective. After all, many of us probably spend too much time contemplating the past or anxious about the future, and we could use a little more presence in the present moment. But if all we had was working memory, it doesn't mean that we would be these beautiful natural animals in tune with the world, because without a longer term memory, it means we couldn't even learn new things. We couldn't learn, like animals do, what foods are poisonous or safe. We couldn't learn language to communicate with others. We couldn't hold memories of where we had gone previously or where our home was or where food is found. We couldn't remember beautiful experiences from our past, and we couldn't even learn new skills, like, you know, learning to walk, which is a skill that has to be stored in the brain based on our experiences. So we need a long-term memory system, and probably one that's pretty complex and nuanced and kind of multifaceted if we want to accomplish all of these functions and more. And that's what we're going to talk about in this video. So the first distinction I want to make is just between two main types of long-term memory. On the one hand, we have what we'd call explicit memory. This is also known as declarative memory. You'll see it written both ways. This generally involves like conscious recollection. Like you're aware that you're retrieving some information from memory. And we're going to contrast that with implicit memory, sometimes called non-declarative memory, which involves completing some task that just indirectly indicates and tells us that memory was involved. Like memory must have been involved. Like something that would only be possible if they're using information that had been stored long term. But this often happens without any conscious recollection at all. You don't think about it as like remembering something. It doesn't feel like you're doing a memory task. You just sort of automatically and unconsciously use the stored information. Like the fact that you understand the words I'm saying right now, it probably doesn't feel like you're retrieving a memory of what each word that I'm speaking means. But think about it. The only way you could understand what I'm saying right now is if your brain is constantly using that past information stored in your brain from when you learned each of those words. So that's implicit memory. And everything in long-term memory can be classified as either explicit memory or implicit memory. So let's break both of these down a little further. I'm going to set up a little chart here just to keep track of the different subtypes of long-term memory. There will be a few. So let's start with explicit memory. There are two main forms that explicit memory can take. One is called semantic memory. This is all the knowledge and facts that you've learned. Like the capital of the United States is Washington, D.C., the capital of Australia is Canberra, and that snow is made up of water and all those other little facts. When we remember facts like this, we're not thinking about a specific point in time. It's not a memory in the sense of reliving some past event. It's just some knowledge that's been laid down in my neurons. Basically, semantic memory is what we describe as knowing that. Like knowing that 3 + 3 = 6, or knowing that the Earth has one moon, or knowing that anyone with two arms has an above average number of arms, or knowing that cows actually moo with a regional accent. Those are real facts, by the way, but this is just facts. It's just knowledge, okay? But there's another type of memory that also qualifies as explicit declarative memory that's a little different than this fact-based knowledge stuff. And that's episodic memory. So this is memory where you're remembering particular events you experienced, like a specific time from your life, like that one time at band camp, or your first kiss, or your first time wearing an inflatable T-Rex costume, or the most recent time you wore an inflatable T-Rex costume, or even just remembering what you had for dinner last night. Sometimes in the cognitive psychology literature, we talk about episodic memory as mental time travel, because you're mentally revisiting a past time. But actually, a lot of the same neural processes are involved when we imagine a specific future event. And some classify that forward type of what-if projection as being part of the episodic memory system. Now, both semantic and episodic memory, those are explicit memory systems. But what about implicit memory? What counts as implicit memory? Probably the biggest and most obvious is what we'd call procedural memory. Basically, this is skill memory, whether it's motor skills like walking or juggling or playing Overwatch, or cognitive skills like using language or being able to do long division. So this is knowing how rather than knowing that. So knowing how, like knowing how to ride a bike, knowing how to tie your shoes, knowing how to kiss well, knowing how to walk, knowing how to string words together grammatically into a sentence, right? Then there's a type of implicit long-term memory that's a little more subtle, but tells us something really important about how our neural architecture is set up. So this form of implicit memory is called priming. Now, don't confuse this with the field of research in psychology called social priming, an area where actually a lot of the early work didn't hold up to replication attempts, and we'll come back to that. What we're talking about here is a different kind of priming, sometimes called semantic priming, but we'll just call it priming to not confuse it with semantic memory over there in the left column. So what is priming? Basically, all the concepts in our brain are laid down in this vast, complicated, ever-changing network of neurons, and the layout of that network, both the neural mapping network and the conceptual mapping network, the layout isn't random. It's based on our past experience, right? So instead we have connections and associations between all the different concepts or schemas stored in our brain. Like our idea of a vehicle is closely related to our idea of car and maybe our idea of truck, and maybe a little more distantly associated with our idea of train or a boat, right? And our idea of car is closely related not just to the concept of vehicle, but also to concepts like Ford and Toyota and sedan and sports and wheels and so on, right? So we've got this vast network of connected concepts and relationships between concepts that's stored in our brain. And what we have discovered as cognitive psychologists is that when you activate the neurons for one concept like Toyota, you're also partially activating or maybe pre-activating or lowering the activation threshold for the neurons that represent similar related associated concepts like car or Corolla or Camry or anything else you might associate with Toyota based on your own individual past experience. Basically, prior activation of one word or concept makes it a little easier or a little more likely for a while for your brain to also activate related concepts, basically to implicitly remember them. And that can affect our behavior. If you've been primed to think about school, say by having a conversation with someone about school, you've been having this long conversation, school, 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 then when you see a moment later the letters B, U, and then a third letter that's smudged or missing, your brain is just more likely to fill that missing letter in with an S, making it B-U-S, bus, rather than fill the third letter with G for B-U-G, bug, right? Your brain was just thinking about school, so bus is quicker and easier to activate than bug or bun or bum or bi or bub or any of the other possibilities. That's priming. Finally, there are a couple other types of implicit memory, although we're not going to talk about these in depth. First, there's associative conditioning. So this includes things like classical conditioning, the stuff where our brain notices patterns in the world where, you know, one stimulus predicts another stimulus, like the brain of Pavlov's dogs. So with Pavlov's dogs, their brain kind of noticed or picked up that the bell always showed up before they got the delicious meat powder. So they started having a sort of preparatory reaction to the bell itself. That's classical conditioning. But this type of implicit memory conditioning would also include operant conditioning, the kind of stuff that B.F. Skinner is famous for studying, where our behavior leads to some outcome, right? It sort of consistently, when I do this behavior, something shows up in the environment. Some stimulus or event happens after my behavior that we either find reinforcing or punishing, making that behavior like more likely or less likely in the future. Like, I don't know, when a kid throws a tantrum, that's a behavior, right? The kid is doing a behavior, throwing a tantrum. If that tends to lead to mom giving the kid a cookie to calm him down, then the kid might throw more tantrum behavior in the future because of that nice reinforcing cookie outcome that shows up every time. So classical conditioning and operant conditioning are both about the brain unconsciously making associations between two things, either between two stimuli in classical conditioning or between a behavior and an outcome in operant conditioning. And that's a form of memory. It's behind the scenes, it's implicit, it's automatic, it's not necessarily conscious, but that is memory because you're storing that information so that it can change your behavior in the future. Finally, there's one last minor form of implicit memory, which is non-associative learning. And we're not going to talk a lot about this, but it includes things like habituation, or what sometimes is called desensitization. Like if you keep activating a reflex over and over again, it gets weaker for a while. That's habituation. And the fact that this is changing your behavior across minutes or hours or days implies that your brain is storing that information in some way. Maybe not consciously, maybe you're not aware of it, but if it's there, it's changing your behavior over time, it must have been stored. So this is a type of memory. Just again, an implicit, an unconscious, behind the scenes kind of memory. Okay, whew, there's our whole big chart of long-term memory. Now, let's learn just a little bit more about each of these. So first, a little about the explicit types of memory on the left here. Why do we think these are genuinely distinct memory systems? Well, some of the earliest evidence comes from the neuropsychological literature with case studies. So like patient KC is a famous case study where brain damage didn't affect semantic memory at all, but it drastically impaired episodic memory. So this patient would remember facts, could tell you how many legs a dog has, or what 18 divided by 9 is, but couldn't retrieve specific events or personal memories, couldn't recall a fancy meal from last week or important life events. On the other hand, we have some other patients, like a famous case study with an Italian lady who had brain damage due to encephalitis, and with her, her episodic memory was intact just fine. She could remember, you know, personal events, but her semantic memory was impaired. So she had trouble with, you know, being able to tell you what a word means or basic facts, trouble remembering just basic knowledge stuff. So what we have from patients like this is a double dissociation, which suggests to us semantic memory and episodic memory are in fact separate processes, separate kind of independent systems. Now, that said, the brain is much more complicated than you know, a simple double dissociation can tell us. So there are some overlapping areas when we have people do like an episodic memory task and a semantic memory task during an fMRI brain scan. We do see some areas that overlap and there's interaction between the systems, but we know they are in some way distinct systems. And indeed, like episodic and semantic memories, despite being distinct systems, they are connected in many ways. Like, we know that semantic memories generally begin as episodic plus semantic. Like it might begin as, I remember learning what declarative memory is watching this video in this particular room while listening to Brian blab about it. That's an episodic memory of this specific event where you're learning the fact, you're laying down the semantic knowledge. But later that episodic part might fade. And what you're left with is just the semantic and kind of fact-like stuff. Like, I remember what declarative memory is, but I no longer can recall the time I learned it. Like years down the road, maybe you remember what declarative or episodic or explicit memory is, but But maybe you don't remember the time that you learned it, what class it was, who was teaching it, where you were sitting, that kind of thing. Like, how many of us can actually recall the episodic memory of the time when we learned 2 plus 2 equals 4? Can you remember when you learned 2 plus 2 equals 4? Or the time that we learned cats have tails? Do you remember that one event, the day when you learned that cats have tails? Probably not. That clearly started with a specific experience back when you had that, but over time the episodic element faded away and now it's just a semantic fact. So there's some connection there. And just as a side note, semantic memories stick better, like we're more likely to remember them later, if they're connected to things of personal significance or if strong emotion was involved during the learning episode. So that, the episodic experience, it is relevant, even if that part of it fades later. Now, at any rate, most people have no trouble grasping the idea of semantic memory and episodic memory, but it's often those forms of implicit memory that we mentioned earlier that are a little more conceptually fuzzy. So let's spend a little time with each of those implicit memory systems. Now, just as a reminder, there's procedural memory, meaning, you know, skills, motor memory, automatic tasks, that sort of thing being stored in the brain. Things that improve with practice, like riding a bike or indirectly drawing while looking in a mirror or something like that. Then there's priming, which again is sort of an unconscious and automatic, you might say, facilitation of a person's thoughts or responses based on recent related experience. And this can happen even if you don't know that you were exposed to anything. So we're often not aware of all the priming that's happening moment to moment and facilitating some of our thoughts and responses. In fact, marketers can take advantage of this, right? And then finally, there's those basic learning processes. So conditioning, which is an associative kind of learning, and then also non-associative learning like habituation. So let's see some examples for each of these types of implicit memory. To really get a feel for how different procedural memory is from other things like semantic memory, let's do a little demonstration. This is gonna work best if you happen to have a friend or family member nearby and you can pause the video to go try the demonstration with them, but you can just try this yourself even if you're alone right now. So here is a silly little made-up scenario I'm gonna give you. Your alien friend from planet whatever has arrived in your backyard. He really needs to get to the airport, but you have no time to take him, nor does his spaceship work, and he has no teleportation technology either. All you have is a bike, which he's never seen and never used a bike before. You have 5 minutes to tell him, to teach him how to ride a bike just with words. So what I want you to do for this demo is verbally describe all the rules involved in using and riding a bicycle. In other words, explain in words, explain how to ride a bike. Like literally take a few minutes right now and explain in words how to ride a bike. If you don't have someone nearby to try this out, you can say it to yourself or write down your instructions. Just get some pen and paper and write it down. But either way, pause the video and take a few minutes to do this as best you can using only words. Okay, how did you find that task? It's surprisingly hard to get across the subtleties of riding a bike just by conveying facts, right? Semantic facts don't necessarily help you figure out how to ride a bike. Even with a diagram of what a bike looks like, it's pretty challenging because really, to be able to ride one, you kind of just have to get on and try it. It takes experience and a little practice to get used to those gyroscopic forces, to shifting your center of gravity the right way as you pedal on each side. That takes some, like, a different kind of learning and memory than just facts, right? So once you know how to ride a bike, it just sort of comes to you. But with a skill memory like that, we don't necessarily even have the explicit knowledge of how it works or how to put it into words. We just sort of do it. We remember a lot of procedural things, even if we can't describe the procedure explicitly. It's just automatic and unconscious once we've learned it. That's why we say procedural memory is an implicit form of memory. This is very different. Like, we may not even be able to use the semantic knowledge to be able to explain how a bike works from a physics standpoint, but that doesn't matter for the implicit form of procedural memory. Now, what about some examples of priming? Since this one's often the most confusing for people who think of it as, you know, as a form of memory. So what do I mean by priming as a form of memory? Here's a fun little example to get us started. I want you to watch for how the early experiences in the video prime her to treat the stimulus at the end in the funny way that she does. Basically, the early examples are going to bias how she responds to the last one. So here's our funny video.
If I were to spell T-W-A, what would that sound like?
Twa.
Twa, right? Okay. Twa. That's really good. Here, you take that piece of paper, but don't let her see it. Just take that away. Okay. What about T-W-E?
Twee.
Twee, right? Twee. T-W-E sounds like?
Twee.
Twee. Okay, you can take that away. Don't help her, guys. Don't help her. What about T-W-I?
Twi.
Twi. That's good. Twi. Don't help her. Don't help her.
Oh, sorry.
Twi. Okay? Twi. Okay? Take that one away. Hide it. Okay? What about T-W-O?
Two.
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 No, sound it out. What is T-W-O?
Whoa.
Mary, don't help her. Coop, what's the problem?
There's no problem.
Okay. All right, hang on.
Try
hang on.
Try from that one more time.
No. Just what? T-W-O?
Two.
Okay. Listen, it's... Listen, okay? You're going to get it. Just sound it out. T-W-O. Okay. Okay. Listen, all right, guys, she's almost there. No, she's almost there. She's almost there, okay?
Okay, sounding out.
Okay. Give her a second. All right, we're gonna settle down. You're gonna get this, okay?
Okay.
All you have to do, you just have to sound it out, okay? Okay. Use your education, okay? Just okay. Oh, we're getting it. Okay. Shush over there, okay? Like.
Oh. Whoa.
What is it?
Whoa.
Okay. Listen. You're really close.
Okay.
But it's not.
Okay. Two.
I mean, kinda.
Two.
Come on. No. Okay. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to give you 5 more seconds, okay?
Okay.
T-W-O.
Whoa.
So that can happen to any of us. Try it out with your friends. It's about priming. So in this case, the word two, T-W-O, it's pronounced without a twa sound, right? But after she went through 3 examples of a twa sound, then some vowel after it, her brain was primed to use that same pronunciation pattern for the T-W-O stimulus, twa, and then some vowel.
If I were to spell T.
Now, for a quick little priming demo yourself, you'll want a pen and paper for this one, so pause the video if you need to go get pen and paper. Okay, we're gonna do a task used all the time in cognitive psychology studies called the word stem completion task. So we're gonna see some words one after another, and you've gotta write each of them down as quickly as you can. They're short words, they're simple words, just each one that comes up on the screen, write it as quickly as you can, okay? So you're gonna write down every word, but just a heads up, some of them will be a full word already there, but some will be a partial word. They'll be missing part of the word. And for those, you just have to fill it in with the appropriate word. Okay, just write whatever word, as long as it fits. But in every case, you're just writing down the word quickly. So are you ready? Here we go. Write it down. The next one's coming quick. Okay, same thing, write it down. Just fill in a word. And again, write this one down. And this one, write a word. And this one, and this one. And this one. And this one. All right, so it went pretty fast, but hopefully you got the words written down. That's enough to give the idea anyway. Now, let's look at some of the words you could have filled in for that first one. For example, things that would fit is chain, charisma, chafe, Charizard, character, champion, chat, charred, chalice, chant, chase, chapstick, and plenty of other words, tons of options here. But if I had to put my money on it, my best guess would be that you wrote down the word chair. And for the second one, there are tons of possible words you could have written in, like sit, sin, situation, silly, sister, sick, sifting, simp, silt, sip, sickle, sir, six, and tons of other possibilities. And yet there's a pretty decent chance that you wrote in the word sink. Likewise, for the next one, a lot of people tend to write in parrot, or maybe party if you use BitTorrent a lot and follow European politics where there's a pirate party involved in politics. And for the last one, book is a really common word for people to write in, even though there are hundreds of words that would fit with starting with a B-O. So why are people so predictable that most would choose the same way to fill in that word stem completion? Because each time we primed your brain with a related concept. Table goes with chair more than it goes with charisma or chapstick. Faucet goes with sink more than it goes with sister or sickle. Now imagine instead you had done the exact same task, but with this as the stimuli. What if I'd shown eraser? And then what? Or stop. And what? Or lot with this. Or white and this. When we use those primes, like if we randomly assign people to get this set, this task, rather than the one you saw, we give people the exact same blanked out word stems on the right side, you would think maybe everyone would give, you know, be equally likely to give the same set of words, but we actually tend to get very consistent answers for this one and different answers, despite the hundreds of possible words that would fit. Now the words that show up super consistently across people, they're different than when you did the demo a moment ago. Now CHA gets filled in as chalk more often than anything else. And the SI blank gets filled in with sign more than anything else. What about PAR? It actually is parking most often. And the BO blank becomes bored more often than not. So this word stem completion task that we did, that shows that our brain kind of jumps to some concepts faster or easier than others based on the other concepts we've recently activated. That's the idea of priming as a type of implicit memory. One way to think of this is our brain stores this whole complex network of relationships between concepts that we've learned. This is often called a semantic network. Starting on like the left here, we've got cow, right? We know that a cow is a mammal. They're in a relationship to each other. Cow is a mammal. And we know that mammal also has that is a relationship with animal. Like a mammal is a animal. We know that birds have that same relationship. A bird is an animal. But notice in this diagram, we might draw birds a little further away. That's meant to depict the fact that our association of bird and animal might be just a little weaker, a little less automatic than our association of mammal and animal. And fish might be even further off, but still associated with animal, just at a farther distance. Now that has nothing to do with the biological science of it. Like all of those count equally as animals within biology, the science, but in our brains, associations come from past experience. And some things just come to mind a little more easily. Some things are more strongly associated. And perhaps due to our mammalian bias, and you know, how much we like fuzzy things, like a lot of mammals are, most of us do tend to associate mammals with the concept animal just a tiny, tiny bit more closely than for birds or fish. But don't get too wrapped up in the specifics of this one depiction of the idea. This is just a simplified model. But the point is, we think all of our concepts are represented in a network-like structure, kind of like this, though, you know, it would be more than two-dimensional. So if I prime you to think about red and then ask you to name a fruit, you're more likely to say apple or cherry or strawberry than you are to say pear or banana. Right? Even though I didn't ask you for a red fruit, I just primed you to think about red first and then asked you to name any fruit, but you're more likely to say a red one like apple, cherry, or strawberry because I primed you to think of red. And that's less like, you know, you're less likely to say something like pear or banana or even a red fruit that just has a weaker association like pomegranates, right? Now, to see an example of how cognitive psychologists kind of probe this semantic network, let's talk about another task we sometimes use in the laboratory called the sentence verification task. So in the sentence verification task, we just provide a simple sentence, which might be true or false, and the person just has to respond yes or no. For example, a sentence might be, a robin is an animal. You'd answer yes, right? A sentence might be, a whale is a tree, and you'd answer no, that sort of thing. And what we're measuring during the sentence verification task is actually your reaction time. It's how quickly your brain can digest and process that sentence and give the correct answer. And it turns out this differs a lot for sentences, even when their structure is asking the same basic kind of question. So for example, if the sentence was, a robin is an animal, you can think of a robin as being maybe a couple steps away from animal in this, you know, hypothetical semantic network I've drawn here. So even though it's true, yes, a robin is an animal, it might take an extra moment for the person to answer that question. And the sentence, you know, if the sentence was a robin has skin, that's true. You'll say yes, a robin does have skin. But it turns out people take a fair bit longer to say yes on that question on average. And we suspect that has something to do with how the semantic network is laid out. So what we think might be happening during the sentence verification task is the brain first activates the concept of that keyword robin, and in doing so, that kind of partially spreads the activation to nearby nodes. Like there's a kind of spreading activation around the robin node. Then for the a robin is an animal sentence, we also search for the keyword animal, right? So we're activating that concept in our brain, but also spreading some activation to all the things with nearby connections to animal. And you know, maybe weaker activations spread to things a little further out from that, a couple steps away. And when we're parsing a sentence like a robin is an animal, when we're making sense of it, not just in the sentence verification task, but in everyday reading or thinking, the idea is that our brain is constantly activating or partially activating in this kind of spreading pattern around the things we're directly experiencing. So for the sentence verification task, if two spreading activations meet, there's a kind of intersection, right, between those two nodes. They meet somewhere in the middle. Now, if there's no intersection, if they don't meet, then it's easy to get a fast decision no. So when we say a robin is a tree, people very quickly say no. The spreading activation doesn't meet very quickly or easily, and so our brain's like, nope, that's not true. But if there is an intersection, then we've got a slower kind of additional decision stage that operates to see if it's a valid sentence. So if there's no intersection, it's pretty quick and easy. But if there is an intersection, there's some time here, and the time relates to the structure of the semantic network. So this idea of spreading activation, we could call it, it's really important, and it's fundamentally what's going on with priming. When you think of or when you're exposed to a particular concept, it activates related concepts, memories basically, or at least it makes them closer to being activated. It lowers the threshold, kind of like we saw with the table, chair, faucet, sink kind of examples a minute ago. So the reaction time data in a sentence verification task looks like this. Where the y-axis on the left there, that's your reaction time in milliseconds, meaning 1,000 milliseconds, that would be one full second. So the sentence, if it was a canary is a canary, or a robin is a robin, or a tree is a tree, that takes about 1 second on average to answer yes. But for something that's equally factual, equally true, like a canary is a bird, or a robin is a bird, it's under 1200 milliseconds, but you know, a little longer, right? A little longer than 1 second. And for a canary is an animal, which again is equally true as a fact, but it takes our brain a bit longer on average to answer that question. Presumably because there are more intervening nodes to spread activation to before that intersection happens in our semantic network and we make the verification. So presumably this is happening all the time throughout your day. If there's a fire engine's siren in the background, you're not even paying attention to it, but a fire engine has been going by, maybe a couple of them headed towards a fire. Even if you're not really paying attention to it, that might make you a little more likely to notice the smell of your toast burning a few seconds afterward. Or if you've just watched a whole bunch of cute dog videos on YouTube for a long time, you spent like an hour this afternoon just watching cute dog videos on YouTube, then 15 minutes later on a phone conversation when you're catching up with an old high school friend and they mention they need to take a moment to feed Jake, you're a bit more likely to think Jake is a pet dog rather than a child because of those videos you've been watching. They primed you to think about dogs. But okay, let's move on to those other forms of implicit memory, like classical and operant conditioning. Those are the most well-known and ubiquitous forms of learning. And what is learning if not storing a memory? So conditioning is basically the learning of associations. It's your brain forming some connections between two or more things. So with classical conditioning, that's an association between two stimuli, a stimulus-stimulus association. The most famous example comes from Pavlov. You've probably heard it before. He had noticed that when he presented a food stimulus to a dog, the dog had a pre-existing reflex, not surprisingly, that made it start salivating as an automatic response. It has no choice in the matter, just a built-in reflex. So specifically, he'd put meat powder in the dog's mouth and the dog would salivate, and he measured how much it salivated, okay? Meanwhile, there are plenty of other stimuli that are totally neutral to dogs that don't make a dog naturally salivate, like the sound with a tuning fork or playing the sound of a metronome or a bell or whatever. Making that sound has no effect on the dog's salivation. So this is just kind of the natural state of dogs. They innately, reflexively salivate to food, but not to a random sound. But then he tried something. He started making sound with the tuning fork right before he'd present the food. And he did this over and over again. He repeated it over and over every day for a while. Kind of like people who set a specific alarm on their phone, like a specific sound, for the same time each day before they go and feed their pet. So what happens when he does this repetitive pairing of these two stimuli, right? We're making an association now in the world between tuning fork and food, stimulus and stimulus association. Well, obviously, when we do this, each day that he's doing the little tuning fork and then the food, obviously the dog is going to salivate. Like, of course it's going to salivate because there's food, right? And the dog already has that pre-existing reflex to salivate for food. So it doesn't matter that you've added in the tuning fork. That doesn't really change anything. Like, there's food and he's salivating. There's food and he's salivating. It's just a reflex. That's not very surprising. The surprising part, the key insight Pavlov documented is that after making that association between these two stimuli, the tuning fork and the food, Pavlov tried using the tuning fork without presenting any food. And sure enough, the dog salivated. Not quite as much as for the actual meat, but like the dog still salivated to this thing it didn't used to salivate to. So something had changed in its mind. It had laid down some information. By pairing up those two stimuli consistently, Pavlov had made the tuning fork a good predictor of food showing up soon afterward. So the brain had caught on, the dog's brain had caught on and learned that predictive association and kind of automatically created a new sort of learned or conditioned reflex. And the reason we're talking about this here is because this is still a form of memory. Even though the dog may not consciously understand anything about tuning forks, the brain has picked up on a probabilistic connection between stimuli and the environment, and it has stored that information, which affects future behavior. That's learning. And by definition, learning is creating memory. Likewise, when a lab rat's brain unconsciously learns that a high-pitched tone always means it's about to be shocked, that's another way of saying it implicitly remembers the association between the tone and the shock. So classical conditioning, it's a form of memory. It's storing a stimulus-stimulus association. But there's also operant conditioning. That's a type of memory, implicit memory, where the brain stores a behavior outcome association, like these cats in the video. They're really cute. They have to ring the bell to get a treat. So when they happen to do the behavior of hitting the bell, a yummy treat stimulus shows up. Behavior, stimulus. Behavior, stimulus as an outcome. It's about picking up on the consistent outcomes that are contingent on their behavior. So unlike classical conditioning, where a behavior happens automatically due to an innate or a learned reflex, here it's a behavior that's kind of under their control, right? But each time they do the behavior, each time something happens after that behavior, and the brain is laying down a memory trace of that behavior-outcome connection, right? That association between their behavior and the outcome that comes after. And with enough such learning, the contingency of behavior leading to the treat, right? That contingency, that behavior always leads to treat. If you do the behavior, then a treat comes. Eventually, that contingency starts to control the behavior. It reinforces it, makes it more probable in the future in this situation. So that's operant conditioning, probably the most central form of learning for all animals, including us humans. But again, that means it's a type of memory. Even if we're not consciously and explicitly recalling the episodes that led to those associations, even if we're not consciously and explicitly aware of the semantic fact about the environmental contingencies, our brain still has stored this information and implicitly uses it to guide our behavior. So it's an implicit form of memory. Okay, and finally, there's this last little type of implicit memory, which is non-associative learning. Stuff like habituation. So habituation, you've probably already have the idea of it, but I'll show you a video example in a moment. Think of it as a reflex becoming desensitized to something. Like, we keep setting off that reflex over and over and over again, and eventually it stops kicking in as strongly. So if you go to the eye doctor and they puff air into your eye, that sets off an eye blink reflex. It's just natural, it happens to all of us. When you go to the eye doctor, puff of air, you're gonna blink, it's a reflex. You can't control it, it's automatic. Now, if you sit at that machine and repeat the process over and over and over again for half an hour, puff, 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 you'll stop reflexively blinking to that puff of air for a while. Like, your brain just stops kicking that reflex in, or it's much weaker, so the eye blink reflex goes down if you keep setting it off over and over again. Likewise, if you tap a snail's shell, it reflexively retreats inside. But if you keep doing this, you keep bugging the poor little snail, you keep tapping its shell, it eventually will stop retreating as quickly into the shell, or even eventually it might stop retreating at all. That's the idea of habituation. Now, there is also a different non-associative learning called sensitization, kind of the opposite, which can happen for some extreme examples. It's not as often, but sometimes where you keep activating a reflex, you might expect habituation, but what you actually get is sensitization. So like if you do something really painful, like a really painful shock or something like that, and you keep doing that, right? Feeling pain, that leads to reflexive responses. When something really painful happens, like getting shocked, you might like jump, right? You have a jump response. It's just an automatic reflexive thing. But if you keep doing that shock, we might not actually habituate to it and jump less. We might actually start to have a bigger and bigger reflexive response to the stimulus each time, becoming extra sensitized. Like if it's something that's really relevant to survival or something like that, sometimes that's that makes us kind of hypervigilant. It makes us more reactive. And that is also a form of non-associative learning. It's not as common as habituation, but notice here for both of these, we're not making an association between two stimuli. So this is not conditioning in the sense of associations between things. This is just whatever stimulus it is that sets off our reflex. That's it. There's no other stimulus that we're associating it with. We're not making an association between our behavior and an outcome, since our behavior just happens reflexively here. It's automatic. That's why we say this is non-associative learning. But it's still a type of memory, because something in our system is storing the information for minutes or hours or days, right? If it wasn't, then our reflexive response would be the same every single time, unaffected by past experience. So let's see a quick video example of habituation where activating a reflex over and over again, right? Habituation means you just keep activating the reflex over and over again in a short period that will weaken the reflex. We'll see that in this example. And just a heads up, a little warning, the video, it's gonna be a video of a rat in a little testing box. It does include a loud noise a little bit that might startle you, just like the rat's gonna get startled. It might startle you a bit if your sound is up really high. So just a heads up. So you're gonna see this rat exploring his little testing chamber, just chilling and exploring his chamber. And occasionally they play a loud sound. Now they're cutting out some time here. It's not as quick together as you see in the video, but you know, the sound is happening during this session where he's, you know, maybe in this box for an hour. The loud sound keeps happening occasionally, and every time it happens, it startles him, right? So being startled by a loud sound, that is a simple innate reflex. We all have it, which is why you might startle a bit to like a loud clap of thunder. Okay, same thing with rats. They get startled by loud sounds too, and you'll see bodily he gets startled when the sound happens. But watch this little guy's brain start to adapt when he keeps getting startled by the same loud sound during this session. So he's startled, right? It's reflexive behavior. Loud stimulus, reflexive behavior. But after a while, and again, we're cutting time out here, it's not all back to back, but after a while, eventually he stops giving a shit. He keeps going about his activity with very little startle to that stimulus. His reflex has gone down, right? Temporarily, it'll come back in a week, but that's habituation. That's a form of non-associative learning, non-associative memory, right? So it counts as implicit memory. So that's our mapping of long-term memory, our long-term memory system, or maybe we should say systems, since as we saw with episodic and semantic, there is some neuroscientific evidence of them being distinct brain systems. And soon we're gonna dive into the biology of memory and see a little more about how implicit memory is a very distinct system in the brain from explicit types of memory. So when you ask someone about their favorite memory, or when someone says, no, I have a bad memory, or when someone says, I can't remember how many US states there are, those are very different from remembering how to swim, or having your thoughts and responses primed by recent experience, or unconsciously salivating because you've learned, or your brain has learned, that a particular smell coming from your oven means pizza is soon gonna be in your mouth. All of these things are long-term memory. They allow us to store and use information over long periods of time, right? Longer periods of time than working memory, longer than 30 seconds, and potentially our whole lives. So that's enough for our tour of long-term memory. As I said, in a following topic, we'll get more into the nitty-gritty kind of biology and neuroscience of memory, and also some of the ways memory can fail us. So I'll see you there.